Bam, Mr. True. In this video, we are going to continue our work of integration using substitution or use substitution or changing the variable of integration. Now, we've had a video on doing indefinite integration. We're going to move on to now working with the first fundamental theorem of calculus along with the substitution to find definite integrals. So, change of variable. If the function u equals g of x, this is again us looking normally at that inner function, trying to find that inner function, letting it equal u, and doing all the substitutions to eliminate all references of the original variable of in your integration expression to that variable of u, has a continuous derivative on the closed interval of ab, and if function f is continuous on the range of function g, then the definite integral of f of g of x times g prime of x dx from a to b is equal to the definite integral of f of u du. But note here, the lower bound instead of being a is g of a, and the upper bound of our definite integral is now g of b. So with indefinite integration by substitution, we did a u substitution, we went through the indefinite integration process, and then we had to, at the end, take the value or the expression that we set u equal to and, you know, plug it back into the original, or plug it back into our final answer to, you know, actually have something in terms of the same variable that the integral started off with. But with definite integrals, we're looking for a numerical value, so we can just change that lower and upper limits of our definite integral by taking that inner function g, that's what we set equal to u, and plugging in a, our original lower limit, and plugging in b, our original upper limit of the definite integral, and that way we can just evaluate this definite integral, get that numerical value, and that's it. We don't have to take whatever u is set equal to and plug it back into the our answer and get it, you know, say back in terms of x. We can just leave it in terms of u, find the definite integral, and we're done. Here's what it's going to look like. Our first example here is we want the definite integral of x times x squared plus 2 to the fifth power dx from negative 3 to 3. Okay, so we're going to look at this expression. We're going to find the inner function, which looks like it's x squared plus 2, because it is inside that other math function of raising it to the fifth power. So we're going to let u equal x squared plus 2, and then du is going to be equal to 2x. I also can see that a lot of clouds rolled in, which messed up my white balance a little bit, so let me pause the tape and fix that white balance, and we'll get back to this example. Okay, I look a little less orange now. So what we can do with this is, forgot the dx. Okay, so we, inside of our definite integral, we have x dx, and we don't have a 2. So I'm going to move this 2 over to the other side. And have x dx. Now, with this u substitution, we're going to take x squared plus 2 out and put in u. With our x dx, we can plug in du over 2, so we're eliminating now, we have enough information here with this equation and this equation to eliminate all references of x, the variable x, and change it to the variable of u in our definite integral. But if we don't remember to change the lower and upper limit of our definite integral, we are of course going to get the wrong answer. So we need to, how are we going to change those? Well, we know the lower limit is x equals negative 3, so we're going to take this u substitution and go and, you know, find that lower limit. So u is going to be equal to negative 3 squared plus 2. See, I'm just taking this lower value of x that was defined by our definite integral and plugging it into this expression. Well, negative 3 squared, keep that negative wrapped in the parentheses, is 9, and 9 plus 2 is equal to 11. And now we need to find our upper limit. So this again was our lower one. Our upper limit is, okay, take the positive value of 3, and u is equal to 3 squared plus 2. Now, because when you raise a negative number to an even power, you cancel out the negative sign, we're going to get the same value of 11, which is a little bit weird. Let's see what happens. We get the definite integral Now we're taking all references of x out and using references of u. So it's going to be, let's see, your x dx was, again, du over 2. instead of writing x squared plus 2 to the 5th, we're just going to write u to the 5th power. And then we have a new lower limit of 11 and an upper limit as well as 11. Okay, so a couple of things here. When we looked at our original lower and upper limit of our definite integral, pardon me, sorry for the interruption, I get the little puppy calmed down. Okay, so clearly we had a lower and upper limit that were different, of course, negative 3 and positive 3. Now our new lower and upper limits are actually the same value. So let's not forget, with a definite integral, one of the properties that we learned of definite integrals is when a and b are the same, or now g of a and g of b, when our lower and upper limits are equal, we're basically, at least, you know, if you think about definite integrals as an area, not the only thing it has to represent, but when you represent it as an area, the lower and upper bound now are the same. You're squishing that area in between the lower and upper bound. It's closed together. There's no area there. So the value of this definite integral, because these lower and upper values are the same, is going to be equal to 0. So I don't really even need to, you know, walk through the first fundamental theorem of calculus to calculate this. Those are equal, so this is equal to 0. That is because this original function turns out to be, when you multiply it out, turns out to be an odd function, and my lower and upper limit values are opposite. So the area, this ends up being symmetric to the origin. So we have some area below the x-axis and some area above the x-axis. odd functions are symmetric to the origin. My lower and upper limits are balanced to that origin, so they're just canceling each other out and getting a value of 0, the same answer that we got without, you know, discussing that idea of odd functions, their symmetry to the origin, and the fact that the lower and upper limits are simply opposites, so we are going to get that area of 0. Let's take a look at one more example. For our second and last example, we have the definite integral of x minus 3 times the square root of 6 minus x dx from the values lower limit of 2 and upper limit on the definite integral of 5. So again, we have a somewhat complicated definite integral here, so we're going to come off to the side and set up our u substitution. We're going to let u equal, now we have an x minus 3 here, but it's not inside a math function like the 6 minus x's underneath that square root symbol. So we're going to let u equal 6 minus x, that's going to make du equal to negative, let's see here, that's a constant, that's 0, so the derivative of negative x is negative 1 dx. Okay, now let's go ahead and take this negative 1 to the other side and write negative du is equal to dx. With this much here, we have enough information to get rid of this reference to x and plug in u. We have dx, which is equal to negative du, but I don't have enough information here with my u substitution yet to be able to get rid of that x minus 3. So we're going to, again, like we learned with indefinite integration, manipulate this equation and allow it to do two different types of substitution. We're going to solve it for, I'm going to solve it for x just to show all the steps, but ultimately I want to change this side of the equation to look like x minus 3 so I have that direct substitution. So we're going to subtract both sides by 6 and get u minus 6 is equal to negative x, and then we're going to divide everything by negative 1, which is going to change this sign. So we have x, it's going to change negative 6 to positive 6 when we divide by negative 1, so 6, and then u divided by negative 1, of course, is negative u. Well, I'm almost there. I have the x, but not the minus 3, so now I'm going to introduce that part to the equation. We're going to subtract both sides by 3 and get 6 minus 3 is equal to 3 minus u is equal to x minus 3. I guess I should pause the video and get that phone. Okay, so what do we have here? I have enough information now to get rid of all my references of x in my definite integral, but we have not changed the lower and upper limits yet. So my lower limit, let's pick a different color here, is, okay, my lower limit is now going to become g of a. So we're going to take the function g, which was that inner function that's our u, so we're going to take the value of 2, and plug it into what we set u equal to. So L, my lower limit, my g of a, is going to be equal to, clean that up a little bit, we have 6 minus 2, which is equal to 4. My upper limit of the integration is going to be g of b, and that's going to be 6 minus my original value of b, which is 5, and we get a value of 1. So a cautionary note here, my lower limit and my original definite integral is a small number like we generally see. You don't have to have it that way, but it's like this often. My upper limit is a larger value of 5. Now, my new lower limit after I finish this u substitution is going to be 4, and my upper limit is going to be 1, a little bit backwards. So don't accidentally put that 1 in the bottom of your definite integral, because it is the value of g of b. It is your upper limit, if you will. So we have enough information. Let's get this substitution done. So we have the definite integral. What was 2 is now equal to 4, going to 1. X minus 3 is 3 minus u. That times the square root of 6 minus x, or u, so the square root of u, du. Now don't forget though, dx was equal to negative du. So if I really want to show my steps, I need to show that this is getting multiplied by negative 1 times du, and then we're going to move that negative 1 out in front of the definite integral, because you can pull out those constants, remember? So again, it's going to be times du with a negative out front. Now at this point, hopefully with your new knowledge of the first fundamental theorem of calculus, and now that we've completed the u substitution, you should be able to finish this. So I'm going to step off, reveal the answer step by step. Maybe you can pause the video, try it on your own, and make sure you're getting these questions right. Do not forget that this is going to come out to be a numerical value, and so when we're done, we're done. We don't need to take the 6 minus x and plug it back in. It's already set up to be finished. So let's see what the answer looks like. Oh, bam! So if this is what you got, we needed to distribute the square root of u through the parentheses. I went ahead and changed that to a u to the 1/2 power so I could add the exponents when I multiply like bases. When you integrate and you're dividing by that fraction, because we had to raise those exponents by 1, let's not forget that dividing by a fraction is the same as multiplying by the reciprocal. And that's how I got this line here, and just continued through the first fundamental theorem of calculus until we got that definite integral value of 8/5. So, I'm Mr. True. Bam! Time to go do your homework.